Welcome, everybody. I'm thrilled to be here. It's great to see a full house. This is really important. I'm Mayor David J. Shapiro, Mayor for the City of Calabasas, for those who don't know me, and I am thrilled to be here along with my colleagues. We have a lot of our City Council here tonight. We have Councilmember Ed Albrecht, we have Councilmember James Bazajian, and we have Councilmember Peter Kraut, who is a living example of what we're going to hear about today in his home already. And of course, we have our former mayor, Mary Sue Maurer, who is here tonight as well. There she is. You keep moving around. So, and I want to acknowledge also our city manager, Kinda Meek, who's here, along with a lot of staff. Thank you for all being here tonight. Robert Yalda and everybody in the Public Works Department and staff who helped put this on. This is really important for us. I did not mean to do that. I'm okay. Stealing your thunder. But I do want to acknowledge our Environmental Commission. They do an incredible job. Let's give them a round of applause. You're going to hear from, I know, a great panel. Beth is here, Beth Giagtiani tonight, and David Cohen were very instrumental in making this happen and bringing this forward. This is so important. We're going to see some rains, some say 30-year rains, some say it's just a couple inches of rain coming forward, but we're not out of the woods yet, and that's why everybody is here tonight to learn what we can and can't do. And I want to turn this over to who's going to be our moderator tonight, but does an incredible job also on the Environmental Commission for the city, J.C. Schillen.
Thank you, David. That was very nice. I am so glad to see so many people came out tonight. Thank you so much. The Environmental Commission put together a program for this forum that encompasses what we thought the community would want to know about. And we brought some people in here who spend their time on this theme, which is to find a way to make your yards and gardens more drought tolerant and to hopefully find a way to use less outdoor water as well. What we're going to do this evening is we are going to have each of our presenters do their presentation, and then when we are done with that, we are going to do a live Q&A. It's going to be fun, Howard is going to bring the mic around, so if you have a question, just raise your hand, and we're going to do a live Q&A, and when we do that, please make sure that you direct your question to whoever you want on the panel, or just make a general, whichever works best for you. So, enough from me. Let's go ahead and get started. Our first presentation tonight is from Eric from the Tree People. Come on up.
Good evening. Thank you, everyone, for coming out. Sounds like this is the first live event kind of in the pandemic era, so I appreciate everyone's time. I'm from Tree People, and in particular, the Tree People Land Trust, which I'll talk a little bit about tonight. So the mission of Tree People is to inspire, engage, and support people to take personal responsibility for the urban environment. And that really dovetails with what I'm going to be talking about tonight. And really, at the end of the day, our mission is centered on people. So Tree People is the name of the organization, but at the end of the day, we are looking at how people can make that impact and make that difference. So just a quick about who we are. Standing on the left there is City Montañez, who is our CEO. She's been with us for about 7 years. I think her 7-year anniversary is this month. It began 50 years ago. So you saw that stamp. Our 50-year anniversary is this year. And it was started by a high schooler, Andy Lipkus, who still is very active in the community. He's moved on from Tree People proper, but he is actually funding the grant, or he's involved the organization that's funding the grant that I am here kind of supported by tonight, and I'll talk about that a little bit. We work a lot on community engagement and empowering communities across the greater Los Angeles area and even kind of moving into Riverside County, Ventura County, so not just LA anymore and the greater LA area. We do a lot of education, we do a lot of on-the-ground research, we do a lot of policy and advocacy work as well. And at the heart, and how I personally became involved with Tree People is through the work in the schools. So I'm near and dear to my heart. So Tree People Land Trust, formerly referred to or known as MRT, the Mountains Restoration Trust. So a lot of people still know it as MRT. We are located at Headwaters Corner, so right across the street from Calabasas High School. That is the Tribal Land Trust now, formerly again MRT. If you say MRT, people definitely know what you're talking about. Land Trust and Tribal just kind of merged in the last, I think it's 2019, 3 to 4 years. The goal of Headwaters Corner in Calabasas is to create that unique educational center that will generate a population of future land stewards, so people that will care for the land and protect the biodiversity of our area. And if those who are somewhat familiar with it, unfortunately, we did have a fire, the old fire in 2016, so predating Woolsey Fire, that damaged our facility. We are looking forward to a new facility in the near future, with the support of the city. So real quickly, I'll just kind of jump through these since I think I have a little bit less time than I originally believed. Some of the key initiatives: greening schools, volunteerism, and visiting parks. So Tree People's main location that people think about is in Coldwater Canyon at the very top, where Mulholland and Coldwater intersect. That is LA city land. Our headquarters have been there for, to be honest, I'm not 100% sure, but I know we've been there for an extremely long time. So community work, social with environmental and social justice, education work through Generation Earth, forestry division, and these are people that go out planting trees, restoring lands, all the way up into the Los Padres, I believe, the Angeles National Forest, so all throughout Southern California. Parks and trails, again, if you've been up to the headquarters in Coldwater Canyon, you'll be familiar with some of the trails and beautiful hiking there. And as I mentioned earlier, policy and research. What I want to talk about real briefly tonight and why I'm here particularly for the Calabasas Environmental Forum is our new Native Garden Kit program. That's my role as the manager of this program. We are rolling this out. We actually are going live next week, so you're getting a sneak preview. Native Garden Kit, what it is, it's an opportunity to make landscape transformation easy, accessible, affordable, and really hassle-free for people. We are intending to help people reduce their outdoor water consumption, beautify the natural urban environment, and then support plant nurseries across Southern California. So we're partnering with nurseries from Camarillo to Azusa down into LA for this first round, and hoping even to expand beyond that as we grow. What we're offering is a kit. It's going to be, I'll show you in the next little bit, a box with 10 one-gallon native plants that are pre-selected, fairly mature, it's that one-gallon size. And for this first round, we're offering a full sun variety. So if you're, say, hey, I've got a plot of land, I want to replace some turf or grass, and I think Alexa, you might talk about that a little bit, in my front yard, ideally so everyone can see it. I've got 100 square feet. We're designing these kits for people to replace that 100 square feet or so of grass. And if you have a partially shaded plot, we also have a kit that we're designing for that, or we have designed and we've sourced the plants for that. In the fall, we'll have more options, and I'm happy to get feedback from people as they think about what might be of interest to them. So here is kind of the mock-up of our kit. It'll be provided to people. I carried the one that was full of 10 plants. It can be heavy. It's about 35 pounds, and it's kind of awkward. So when we have, these will be available for pickup. We're not sending them in the mail. We are not delivering them to people, but we will be helping people to put them in their vehicle. So each kit comes with, as I mentioned, 10 one-gallon plants, a plant-by-number site map. So really like an landscape architectural layout where you could see, hey, this is my plot of land, whether it's perfectly square or some other orientation. I'm going to put the plants here that are laid out in a way, thinking about when they become, reach full maturity, that they will fill in and cover that 100 square feet. They are a little bit slower growing native plants than what we might think of as conventional or traditional plants, so patience is always appreciated. And then, because we are really an educational organization at the heart of what we do, we have an installation guide with lots of educational materials. We've been working on projects like these for years. I've taken a lot of the great work that people before me have done and kind of put it into this single multi-page kit. So what is the kit? Or why are we having these? Reducing water consumption. According to studies, up to 70% of residential water consumption is allocated to our lawns. It varies, but that is a fairly standard recognized value. The benefit of native plants in this idea, in this iteration, is once they are established, and that establishment is about doubling in size, they actually do not require irrigation beyond if we have a winter drought like we had last winter, where I think January and February were the driest January and February on record. They would need supplemental irrigation during those times, but otherwise, once they're established, they are adapted to our climate. And even as the climate has fluctuations from year to year, that's really the piece, is once they're established, they are good to go. It supports our wildlife and our pollinators. Roughly a third of all of our food comes from pollinators, so supporting them and having resources and food for native pollinators that exist here in their natural habitat is vital. They do not feed off of most of the plants, even if they are drought tolerant. They don't actually use the food sources from non-native plants. So we are really encouraging people to think about native plants. And this idea that they also doesn't require a lot of pest management. They have evolved to deal with pests in their own way. A lot of plants that you'll find in their natives are deer resistant. They have defenses that have evolved over years. And then maintenance, foregoing fertilizer. Natives have evolved in this kind of low water climate. They don't require additional inputs like fertilizer. It's minimal. Santa Monica City College, I know Alexa had turned me on to this research that was done. There's a reduction from 80 hours of maintenance on a traditional lawn to 15 hours on a native, in a side-by-side comparison that Santa Monica City College had done. So that's at the end of the day, is a dollar amount in people's pockets that they don't have to spend as much time, as much money, resources maintaining native plants. So just real quickly, this graph here shows in blue is our annual rainfall by month. So January, February, you see our first 3 months of the year get most of our rain. That is the red line or the red dots, which coincide almost perfectly. That's the water requirements for natives. It is a coevolutionary benefit that the native plants have evolved to take advantage of when we get rainwater historically. Obviously, as I mentioned, if we have drought during the winter, that is when supplemental water is needed. Here's that Santa Monica City College study I mentioned. You see the maintenance hours from 80 down to 15. The water is a nearly 90% reduction that they found in what a traditional grass-intensive landscape with other roses and marigolds, other plants you find typically. And then yard waste is even reduced by over half, from 670 pounds to 250 pounds. So just real quick, the future of these kits, we're looking to eventually have a workforce development program where we have young people either in high school or recently out of high school help to train them on installing, so removing lawn and installing people if they're looking to replace their irrigation system as part of this, and planting the natives, and also helping support people who are applying for rebates. There are a lot of rebates currently out there. I live in Thousand Oaks, but I removed my lawn last fall and went through that process, and there is money available to people. It's just they ask that you follow very clear guidelines. Education opportunities. We are looking to put a demonstration plot at Headwaters Corner. I just dropped off our 10 sample plant kit. And then hopefully having garden tours once people have planted these and want to share with the community. This is what I've done. This is what it looks like. And successes and failures alike. Not every plant is going to thrive. And that's okay. I think part of that idea of making sure that we tend them, but also understanding that not every plant's going to survive. And then fall kits, we're looking at offering. So we're offering 150 in the spring, 100 full sun and 50 partial. We're looking at 250 in the fall with one to two new designs. Some of the ideas for possible kits might be a coastal kit. So not Calabasas, but maybe the Friends in Malibu, having a kit designed based on the plant palette that the city of Malibu has approved. Also looking at things like a Firewise, Firescape plant palette, a wildflower, a pollinator specific, a chaparral, which obviously the hills around us are, the chaparral, and then aromatic, which there's a lot of crossover with some of these other species. And there are a couple others as well, but these are some of the ideas that we're throwing about. We have a couple partners with this, Las Vegas Municipal Water District, who was an early idea generator, and I know Alexa might be able to speak a little bit about that. ARLA, and that's the organization that's providing the grant through which it's funded, and ARLA is where Andy Lipkus is now. So he was the founder of Tree People 50 years ago. He's now at ARLA. And Dashboard Earth, and we have a representative here from Dashboard Earth. And Dashboard Earth is an app that you can download that will help you track your impact if you do decide to, not just for the Native Garden Kit program, but they have created a specific pathway for us and that you can track the impact. So if you purchase one kit, it'll help calculate how much water you're saving annually. And a multiplier, if I'm not here to sell them to you per se, but if you were to decide, hey, I'd love a couple of them, it'll help you track the water consumption, savings, over multiple kits. And then also has information about rebates and rewards, has other information about how to care for your native kit. It'll send you reminders, so definitely trying to help support people as they make that transition. That's for my speech. Hopefully I'm within that kind of maybe 12-ish minute range. I don't know if you're following. But if you have any questions, you can reach me, nativegarden@treepeople.org. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Eric. Thank you, Eric. Okay. I know I already have questions, so.
Write them down.
Yeah, I started to. Okay, so our next presentation is from the Las Vegas Municipal Water District, and Alexa Hendricks is our speaker. So please give her a round of applause.
Hi, good evening. Thank you so much for having me. As was said, I am Alexa Hendricks. I am the Resource Conservation Supervisor at the Las Vegas Municipal Water District. Here to talk to you about how to create. Oh, let me see if that will go away. There we go. Nope. What's happening? That's okay. It's just captioned, I guess. How to create a climate appropriate landscape and presenting this material specifically through the filter of applying for a rebate. So if you want to get financial assistance to support this process, as Eric said he had, as I've done myself in the past. So I know we've all kind of been beaten over the head with this in the last several months, so I'll keep this brief. But as we all know, we ended the year 2022 in pretty rough shape. 2022 was the third consecutive year of drought, and that was right on the heels of the 2012-2016 drought. So the impacts of the most recent drought were even compounded by the fact that we hadn't yet recovered from the prior drought. So we were in really poor shape ending 2022. The great news is that we have started this year in really fantastic shape. So you can see the side-by-side drought monitor maps there, and it shows how we've improved as of February 14th. So LA County there, though, is still noted in the abnormally dry to severe drought category. So as was said by our mayor, it's still important to be aware that we are not out of this. We don't want everybody bringing back the sod. This is going to be an ongoing situation. I think we all know now drought is something that reoccurs. So we really want to talk about developing gardens that are climate appropriate and not kind of the conventional European landscapes that we've all seen in the past. One thing that I want to really make sure to note is, where does our water come from? So few people are aware of this. So there is what is called the State Water Project. It is basically a series of canals and pipes that run from Lake Oroville in Northern California over 700 miles down to Lake Paris in Riverside County. That delivers water from basically mostly snowmelt from the Sierras from Northern California down to Southern California, operated by the California Department of Water Resources. In Los Angeles, there is a water agency, Metropolitan Water District of Southern California. They import water from the State Water Project via the California Aqueduct. So the California Aqueduct begins right in the Central Coast in the San Joaquin-Sacramento Delta area. So the California Aqueduct is 444 miles that run from there down to Los Angeles. Las Vegas is a member agency of Metropolitan. So what does that mean? We purchase our water from Metropolitan Water District, and we partner with them on customer rebates. And Las Vegas is what is known as a State Water Project dependent area, meaning all of our water comes from the State Water Project. So a lot of our neighboring counties or neighboring communities have groundwater, can access the Colorado River. They have other resources. We, within the Las Vegas District, so Hidden Hills, Calabasas, Agora Hills, and Westlake Village, 100% dependent on that water. Every single drip when you turn on your faucet has just traveled over 400 miles from the San Joaquin Sacramento Delta. So we import all of our water and then purchase it from Metropolitan. So if that isn't reason enough, but why consider a climate appropriate landscape? Well, this was mentioned before. California has a Mediterranean climate, meaning we have wet winters and hot, dry summers. Average rainfall in our region is about 9 to 15 inches per year. Well, as was pointed out, average households in our region use about 60 to 70% of their water outdoors. So all that water that we're importing to this area, 60 to 70% of it is being used to maintain our landscapes. So not even being put towards basic human health and safety needs. Traditional landscapes need about 45 inches of water per year. So you can see if we're only naturally receiving about 9 to 15, but our landscapes are requiring 45 plus, we're having to supplement, and that's where you turn on your irrigation system. So in enters the turf replacement program. So what is the turf replacement program? It is a rebate that's offered through the Water District, Las Virgenes, as a member agency of Metropolitan. So you're actually applying with Metropolitan Water District. But you are eligible as a customer to receive $2 per square foot of turf grass removed. Residential projects have to be between 250 and 5,000 square feet to qualify. Before starting your project, and I cannot stress how important this is, before starting your project, you want to go to socalwatersmart.com and apply for a reservation, for a rebate. To apply, you need to have a copy of your most recent water bill, a simple landscape plan, and at least 5 color photos of your property. I'm gonna emphasize simple landscape plan. I think this holds a lot of people up. They think they need like a professional landscape architectural drawing. Simple landscape plan. They just wanna be able to show that you put thought into your project and that you have a vision for that space. So don't be hung up on not being a professional landscape architect. Just do a little research and think it through. You know, most of them are hand-drawn. If you have the ability to use a computer or some kind of software, great. Hand-drawn is perfectly fine. Some common pre-approval denials to be aware of. Not enough plants. There is a requirement of 3 plants per 100 square feet. Pictures don't show landmarks. You don't want pictures of your grass. They want to be able to say, you know, in the space, what's the context of the photo. The project has already begun. So if you've already removed your grass, you cannot qualify. And no pre-existing turf. If your turf is dead, that's perfectly fine. You can apply with photos of dead golden dye turf. It just needs to be still in place. So the application timeline, you want to do your preparation. Now is a perfect time to start thinking through some of those preparation pieces. You know, take photos of your landscape and develop a landscape plan. Then you're going to go to socalwatersmart.com and apply for a reservation. It takes about 2 weeks after you submit your application to get approval. And then you have 6 months from the time you receive that approval email to complete your project. And we'll talk about some of the details of completing a project. Once you've completed your project, you log back in, apply for your rebate, and you'll get a check about 8 to 10 weeks after that. So how to remove your turf grass? This is best done during the summer months. So there's many different ways to remove turf grass. These are just 3 of the most common. So solarization, this is a process where you lay clear plastic sheets over your lawn and basically cook your grass. It kills the lawn without harming the beneficials that live underneath, the microorganisms. The cons, it does take some time, about 3 to 8 weeks, depending on the type of turf grass you have and the time of year. The plastic can break down and it creates plastic waste. And then, of course, there's sod removal, which is just physically digging out or removing your sod. You get immediate results. Again, you can remove it without harming the beneficials that live in your soil. The cons, it's physically intensive, depending on your approach to it, and it creates green waste if you're not directly composting, you know, the sod that you're removing. My preferred method, and I know Tree People advocates for this method as well, is sheet mulching. Sheet mulching is a process where you slowly decompose your grass under layers of cardboard or paper, compost, and mulch. The pros, it improves your soil health. It leaves 0 green waste. You don't need any heavy equipment or pesticides or herbicides. The cons, it takes some time. It takes at least 1 to 5 months. This is why it's best if you do this in the summer. If you start your sheet mulching in, say, May, June, July, You lay down, it's called sometimes called sheet mulching lasagna. You lay down your layers and you just let them sit for the summer months. You stop all your irrigation, your grass will decompose, and then in the fall, you're primed for planting. So plant selection and planting. Planting, best done during the fall. So exciting to hear that Tree People will be launching more of those plant kits in the fall. So those will be available for us. One thing to be aware of when selecting your plants is a concept called plant factor. You'll also hear it called crop coefficient. Basically, it's just the water requirements of your plant. So you can see there, turf grass requires 45 inches per year. This is conventional cool season turf grass. Plant factor is a value that's derived from that being your reference species. So if cool season turf grass requires 100%, it's a plant factor of 1. All other plant factors are based on that reference species. So you can see moderate, you know, uses about half as much. You have low water use plants, which use 9 inches or less, about 10 to 30% of the water requirement of your reference species, or very low. So when you're shopping for plants, you want to make sure that you're looking for plants that work within our environment. So you can see the water requirement there of 5, 9, or 23 inches. Think about where you live and what plants, like Eric was saying, once established, will naturally thrive in that environment. So what are some resources for identifying what those plants are? California Native Plant Society is a really great resource. They have an online database called CalScape. As was mentioned, native plants co-evolved in this climate, so they're going to thrive in the natural environment. Some other resources, because we don't have time to get into individual plant selection, but UC Davis has the WUCALS database. So you can actually, if you just look up WUCALS, the acronym there, Water Use Classification of Landscape Species, they have a full online database where you drill down based on where you live, what plants in the low, high, moderate categories will work well in your environment. There's also bewaterwise.com, which is a really tremendous website put together by Metropolitan Water. They have plant guides based on individual counties on their website. And then also there's Las Virgenes. I brought with me our California Friendly plant guide. It's California Friendly and drought tolerant. So it's not all native, but it increases the palette to include plants from other Mediterranean climate types so that you can see what other plants from around the world would also thrive in this environment. Also, I encourage folks to visit our sustainability garden at headquarters. We have plants grouped in themes, and it's a self-guided tour. It's open to the public 24/7. You can visit the garden and see what kinds of plants are thriving right here in Calabasas. So where do you find some of these plants? The great thing is that they're becoming increasingly more available. It used to be really hard to find them. There's people like Tree People who will do all the work for you and assemble a kit and provide it for you. So if you want to go that route, strongly encourage. But these are just a few of the local nurseries that stock climate appropriate, drought tolerant plants. Nearest to us, both in Treeland Farms, they've really expanded their drought tolerant selection. So great resource right here in the community. Low flow irrigation. So it doesn't do any good to change all your plants if you don't change your irrigation. You're not going to be saving any water. You're not going to be saving any money. So you need to upgrade your irrigation system to a low flow irrigation system. Conventional spray heads are only about 50 to 60% efficient. So a lot of that water is lost to like misting and other causes. So that means, if you think about it, to maintain that cool season turf grass that requires 45 inches of rainfall per year, you actually are applying twice as much water because of the inefficiency of your irrigation just to keep it healthy. So you're applying 90 plus inches per year. So if you alternate instead to some of these low flow options, hand watering using a positive shutoff valve right at the root level is an option. Drip irrigation. Drip irrigation is about 90% efficient. So highly efficient means of irrigating your plants. Applies water very slowly, you know, gallons per hour versus gallons per minute. And high efficiency nozzles, another great strategy to take, about 70% efficient. And there's a rebate for nozzles too, $2 per nozzle. So you can couple some of these other rebates with the turf rebate, increase your savings potential with your project. So now applying for your rebate, you applied for the reservation and Metropolitan is holding your reservation for you. Once you complete your project, you log back into the system and you complete step 2. Of the application, they're going to expect you to submit at least 8 color photos, so they want to see the after of your project. Again, a copy of your water bill. And then through those photos, they're going to make sure that you have the required plant coverage, a rain retention feature, which we don't have time to get into now, but all the details can be seen on the website, as well as your upgraded low-flow irrigation system or hand watering, which is perfectly acceptable. Maintenance is key for any of these types of landscapes. I cannot stress enough, mulch, at least 2 to 4 layers of mulch over bare soil. It reduces weeds, reduces evaporation, reduces runoff. It moderates your soil temperature, so it'll stay cooler in the summer, warmer in the winter. You might also consider amending your soil with compost. We provide compost for free at our Rancho Composting Facility on Las Virgenes Road. Water deep and infrequent. Really can't stress that enough, especially with natives. You really want to water deep and infrequent. And then pulling weeds, because you want to make sure that you're reducing competition for resources in the environment. We flew through that, so just some resources in the future if you want to learn more. We have a couple of workshops coming up March 14th. We are hosting a virtual garden design workshop. On April 1st, in person at headquarters, we're hosting a firescaping workshop, protecting your family, home, and property from a wildfire. And then we also have a planting a California native garden, still date to be determined, and a sheet mulching workshop that we'll be doing before summer. A lot of these are going to go live on our website on Monday, so just keep an eye. You can see lvmwd.com. Keep an eye on our website, or if you follow us on social media, really great way to learn about upcoming workshops and opportunities to learn more. So with that, I know we're holding questions till the end, but I'll go ahead and pass it back. Go ahead.
Thank you, Alexa. That was very interesting. And in addition to the question and answer, we also have the presenters all have tables, and they have some materials, and we also have some additional vendors with us. So we'll talk about that after, but I just wanted to remind everybody. Okay. Last on our speaker list is Ms. Heather Milton from the city.
Someone's doing it for me. Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Heather Milton. I'm the Landscape District Maintenance Manager here for the City of Calabasas. I don't know where to put some of my stuff here. So I'm going to go over some of the things that the city has been implementing since approximately 2012 to 2014. We have a very active environmental commission, and we have great support here. And our council has been very active in being proactive in things that we can do throughout the city. So I'm going to go over really fast what we started with and where we're at and where we're heading real fast. I'm not sure. No, let's see here. Okay, here we go. So back in 2014, the city was awarded a grant from the state to convert the approximately about 52 irrigation controllers throughout the city from non-weather-based controllers to weather-based. They did these mostly in the city parks and other common medians, parkways, that are managed by the city and were either potable water or reclaimed water. In 2015-2016, more money was available to switch out then the nozzles, and there were some large projects on the west side where we used low-flow sprinkler nozzles by Toro. And Toro also, as well, had provided grants to the state and distributed them statewide, not only statewide, but all the way nationwide, to reduce the use of water. And that was approximately 2015-2016. We did Thousand Oaks Boulevard, we did sections of Las Virgenes Road and Lost Hills. We also did sections on Mulholland Highway down in front of Gelson's. These combined projects, just from 2014 to 2016, with the help of the Las Virgenes Water District, we were able to have a savings of approximately 35% in the use of reclaimed water. During that time, our council was very active, and we worked together, and started the Green Street policy, which was implemented. This policy was implemented so that further installations of parkways, redesigns of parkways, upgrades of parkways, installations of roundabouts or medians, none of them will have irrigation. Most of these new medians, Valmar Road, Malibu Hills Road, and other locations do not have actual irrigation. It is all temporary. It's temporary netafim that we run in the landscape. It runs for an establishment period from 3 to 6 months, and then it is taken out. Then we do not water. The only time we water is supplement watering. We have a hose bib, and we do supplement watering. Otherwise, for example, like Las Virgenes, Valmar Road, or the corner of Malibu Hills Road, where they just did the new sidewalk, that's all temporary irrigation, or the irrigation has already been removed. All of those plants there are either native plants or they are drought-resistant plants. Part of the reason for that is because it is reclaimed water. They are very high in nitrates, and a lot of your natives do not do well, especially when we are not getting the rain amount that we need to flush those soils out. So what we do is we use some drought-tolerant mixed with native plants, and by doing that, we ensure that we still, one, don't have to water, and two, you still have a nice variety, where the whole object that I'm trying to do is to get multiple blooms through the year. So I'm choosing plants that might bloom, some bloom in the fall, some bloom in the winter, some bloom in the spring, some bloom in the summer. So by having that and different depths, textures, colors, I'm trying to replace your normal herbaceous plants that you're accustomed to seeing. Some of these mediums as well are also bioretention. So they're collecting the water. They're collecting the water off of the streets as well. It comes into the medians and then is giving that deep saturation that she spoke about earlier that these plants need. We do not fertilize some of these medians. We do not fertilize Valmar. We do not fertilize the corner at Headwater Corner. We do not fertilize Monroe Road. We do not fertilize. That has gradually all been removed. And the reason for that is it teaches the natives, again, how to bring up the nutrients that they need naturally. And that's what you want. In 2021 and 2022, as you know, in July 2021, the governor requested the volunteer reduction of water use statewide. Our city and our council was very active in supporting this, and they immediately came and asked, what can we do? Immediately, we reduced. We already started reducing. We reduced 25% in that winter time. Then after we did that, we also were not only reducing the areas where we had very little potable water, the city has very little potable water, but we went ahead and we did the reclaim. Even though there was not a restriction on reclaim, we still did a reduction. As many of you know, in the late spring, because it's been so warm, through summer, the water district does put approximately 9 to 11% of potable water mixed into the reclaimed water. And our council wanted to do what they could to do their part citywide and reduce that. So what we did is, even though there was not restrictions on the reclaimed water, the city chose self-restrictions. We reduced down to 3 days a week and 8 minutes a day, even the reclaimed water. When we did all of this, we reduced the water consumption in the landscape by almost 42%. So you guys need to clap for yourselves as well, because you guys supported it. Also, as you know, in the spring of 2022, The city also reduced, and we began the transition. When I mean we began the transition, we knew this was coming. We had already started in 2021. By the time 2022 appeared, we knew that more was going to be done. We already had heard from the State Water Board more was coming down the road. So the City Council said, what can we do? Bring us some ideas. So immediately what we did is we stopped doing the annual color in other areas. We also looked at areas that were potable water. How could we change those? We also looked at non-functioning grass areas. How can we change those? What can we do? So what we did is we put a list together and prioritized this list. And then we came up with a strategy, and I started designing. And then one of the problems we immediately ran into is, as you all know, it's not just Calabasas. It's not just this area that is in drought. It's the whole state, from the south to the north. So resources for plant stock became very limited. So we would, I'd make these lovely designs, and then I would start getting bids, and there's no plants, or we only have five of these, but we have 20 of these, or we have two of these. Well, when you're designing 55, you know, 100 square feet, two of one, it's just not gonna work. So what I had to start doing is I had to start calling a lot of friends in the industry and find out who had stock. I had to find out who was gonna have stock in the next 5 to 12 months. And we started promising, please, I will purchase those. Just put a little ribbon around them. Save them for us. So once we identified these areas, to give you an example, we had Old Town, the Tennyson Swim, Mulholland Highway, and then some of the non-functional park areas. Old Town, as many of you might know, it was going through a construction period and they were revamping it. So one of the things we did is there was also a design to show more of a rustic look, but not necessarily rustic, but more of a reflection of what this area used to look like. And so what we did is we had thought we had come up with a great planting plan, and we handed it off, and unfortunately at the time, and everyone can start laughing from Public Works, I went on vacation for a week and I came back and I didn't recognize any of the plants. And so I go walking down there and a young associate engineer says, I think you might be a little upset. And so I go walking down there and I didn't see any natives, I didn't see any drought resistant plants. And so this gentleman walks up to me, he goes, well, what do you think? I said, I think it looks awful. I said, that wasn't my plant list. I don't know what happened to it. And he goes, well, I don't know what to do now. And so it's a big joke with everyone. I rolled up my hands and I said, I do, we're moving all of this. We're not using it. It's a no. And I said, no, no. And then I told everyone, do not let council come down here. Do not let Robert come down here. Do not let anyone come down here. We are going to get screamed at. No, no, no. And so we started making a whole bunch of phone calls. And I said, you know what? I have a better idea. They're not going to do the work at all. Because at that point, I was mad because I had specifically made the list. And I don't know. I guess they didn't like the list and they decided they wanted something new. But so gradually we have gradually, step by step, been redoing Old Town. And I've been bringing in some different types of native plants along with some succulents and some drought resistant plants. What we did is some of the plants we couldn't get, some of them we only had, you know, a sporadic amount. So what we did is the Tennyson Swim really needed to be vamped. It had a lot of thirsty plants. So what we did is we took out the whole front, we took out all the perennials, we took out all the color, and that's what we started doing. So what I was hoping to do is some of the plants also I was choosing, you can take cuttings off of. So my object was to get plants that we could take cuttings from and then spread them, you know, recycle. And spread them so there was more of a theme going through the city. But these are also plants that, one, are drought resistant, and two, you can pinch, just put them right in the ground. They don't need much water, especially if you do it during the winter, and they will survive. You just got to give them a little love and some time. They might not, you know, fill the whole area real fast, but they'll get there. Just, you know, relax, enjoy, look up in the sky, I don't know. So anyways, this is some of the ideas that we came up with. Is we've got different types of, if you walk down Old Town, we have different types of calancho. I have aloe, I have some native salvia, I have some Mexican bush sage, I have, it's a mix of plants, and that was the idea. I have some Santa Barbara daisy. And what I did is, one of the things I wanted to let you guys know is there's tons of resources. If you go to Pierce College, I'm part of the UC Davis Extension. I work with Cal Poly. I graduated, go Mustangs. I went to the Royal College. And so you can go online to any of these colleges. It is a network, and there's tons of material out there. Once that was all done, we gradually started doing more and more areas. It's people like you that you have the patience, you give us that time. So you are our cheerleaders out there. You know, this can grow, and it can be very successful for this community. It can be successful for everybody. It just takes a little patience and time. But we can get there, and it's a lot of education for people that are very accustomed to one look or one idea. Natives and drought-resistant plants are wonderful. They're needed for all your insects. They're needed for the bees. They're needed for your butterflies. Not one plant is used by one insect. You know, a butterfly might come and it might take this mallow at one stage, but for the next stage it needs another plant. So to understand that, you need these native species, and you need these, I guess, native species, and you also need these drought-resistant plants, because they will better in the environment. They're going to help your soil, and you're going to use less fertilizer. You're going to, once it adapts, it will hold that moisture in there, and your heat index around your home, or if you're walking up and down the street exercising, it will get reduced. These are just some suggested plants I wanted to show you. Everyone thinks, you know, what do I do with these? But when I was putting my plant list together, or when I was trying to come up with ideas, and I kept being told that it wasn't available, I had to come up with other ideas, because the whole object, like I said, was I needed different textures. I needed to make sure that the residents that were calling in that had concerns because they didn't like something, that I listened, and that. So I had to adapt a little bit to make some people happy and, you know, and hear their voice. But not just native trees, the Chautauqua, it's a great tree. It's out in front of the Las Virgenes Water District. It's a great tree. It might not be native to here. It's actually native to more of your southern eastern side of the United States, but it's a great tree. It adapts very well here. It's not a messy tree. I'm using them all over. You have the Lagostromia. The biggest thing is, before you just go out and get some plants, what I always tell people is understand the microclimates where you live. The microclimate over off of Mulholland Highway is extremely different from Las Virgenes Row and Moreau Road. Everything over there freezes. So we have about four microclimates, or actually five. The Highlands is different too. So you have about five microclimates. So just kind of know your plants. Don't be afraid if one dies, it's okay. But just kind of know your plants, and or not necessarily know them, but maybe try one or two instead of dumping all your money into this is what I'm going to do. It's okay to go a little small and then gradually grow from there and see what is really working for you and what isn't working for you.
10 plants. 10 plants.
Follow her lead. So what I wanted to do is just give you guys a little bit of some suggested plant materials that I've been using and I have found successful in different areas in Calabasas. The last thing I want to say is another really, really good book to give you an idea is by Susan Van Atta, and she specializes in native plants. I've seen her lecture. Oh, sorry. I've seen her lecture several times, and her aunt actually lives here in Calabasas, but I went to school with someone that works with her, and I used to lecture. And what's very interesting about this book is it breaks it down to a low plant, medium-sized plant, and a tall plant, and then different colors. And you can get this here in the library. You're happy to look at it. You can come to City Hall. I have people that come in all the time and borrow my books. So, but they're really good books. There's some very good books out there. And the other book from Las Virgenes that she was talking about earlier, it's a wonderful book. I actually go there all the time, and they're very nice. Customer service gives me about 10 to 15 about every 3 months, and I pass them out. And it's a really good book because it gives you that variety. So I hope that helps you.
All right, so if you would like to ask a question, please raise your hand and Howard will come. Oh my goodness, hands already.
Stand
all right,
up.
Howard will come and please address the panelists or all of them, however you want to do it.
For tree people, how much is a kit?
Excellent question. So the kits are going to be $160 and we'll have pickup hopefully at Las Virgenes Municipal Water District's headquarters on Las Virgenes Road.
And who do we contact to order it?
So the site will go live next week.
Okay.
You can go to Tree People's website and check on it. But treepeople.org/yards. And you'll see right now it says coming soon. But our goal is March 1. And the actual pickup date, we'll have several dates the week of March 20th. We're actually looking at that 21st, which is the spring equinox, 21st, 2nd. 23rd and 24th, we'll have various times to pick up, and that'll all be available via email as well.
Yeah.
Next.
We have gophers, and how do they react with native plants?
Who wants to take that?
Gophers.
Not golfers.
Okay. Gophers. Okay. So, actually, there is some native species of plants that are, they will go around. There is a list. I actually do have a list that do better or are a little bit more resistant than some of the others. The biggest thing for gophers, though, that I find is to have some type of a border. So I'm not sure where your problem might be. If you have a raised bed, that always helps. Usually if you have some type of a boundary, whether it's some type of a border, whether it's a DG border, or whether it is some type of a pea gravel or even a mulch border that's anywhere from 8 to 12 inches, that usually helps as well. I'm not sure what your situation might be, but that always helps.
We've actually put mesh underneath and then put our plant material on top of that. And as long as you maintain that, you cut holes in the mesh, and then you put your plants in there and everything works out. Yeah, yeah. Right. Another question here.
Just one comment, one question. So for our landscaper designer, for those of us who have come from Brooklyn and know nothing about plants except that they exist, I understand that. I heard that rumor. Maybe even two, but I've never seen them. My thought was when you plant these new plants, wherever you're planting them, might it not be a decent idea to put a sign that says, hey, this is what this is. So for those of us who walk past and say, gee, we like this, maybe we'd like to have this at our house, at least we would be able to identify it.
Actually, Mary Sue's smiling at me. That was actually an idea or that is something that the city is hoping to do around City Hall and at some of the parks. And we're actually working, and I believe it's going to be March 19th, I'm not positive, with the Malibu Foundation. And over at De Anza Park, there's going to be a native, they're going to be seeding and they're going to be planting, and then we're going to come back in and we are going to try to identify a lot of the plants for people. Some of it is going to be saplings and some is going to just be shrubs. Are you helping provide some of the plants for that Malibu Foundation project?
Possible.
Yeah. Oh, okay. But that's the hope. And it's going to be at De Anza Park as well. So that is one of the things. And then I worked with a young Eagle Scout, and we're in the process. He just finished planting it at Pocket Park. And for anyone who doesn't know where Pocket Park is, that's on the corner of Moreau Road and Las Virgenes. And over Christmas, we removed the turf, and this young man planted, I got some natives, he planted the natives, and then he's adding a little bit more DG and stuff. And then once that's done, the communications department here is going to help me, and we're going to put signs there as well.
And Alexi, just a question for you. You had mentioned something in your presentation about when you submit an application to Metropolitan Water District for a rebate to have some sort of a rain retention device, but I'm not exactly sure. Now, I've been using for years, which is phenomenal, an internet-based weather-dependent sprinkler controller. So I don't have to make any adjustments. It adjusts it for me by the weather. Fabulous. Would that satisfy the need, or is there some other thing that they would require?
That would not satisfy the need. I still very much highly recommend weather-based irrigation controllers. Like Heather mentioned, that they're deploying them across the city. Las Virgenes has a rebate for the Ratio 3 weather-based irrigation controller, but that doesn't satisfy the requirement. That requirement is specific towards some kind of stormwater retention feature within your landscaping. So it can be as simple as a rain barrel. So you can put a rain barrel on a downspout on one of your gutters. You could put a series of basins and berms just to kind of add some topography to your landscape so that it holds water. You know, all of our landscapes are designed, if you look at them, they're all slanted to the street. They're all designed to get water off your property as quick as possible. So the intention with the rainwater feature is that rather than just having all that water go into the gutter and into the storm drain and out to the ocean, is that you're actually holding it on your landscape so that it can saturate, it can infiltrate into your soil and provide that deep water that's so necessary for plants. So you'll often see like bioswales or a rain garden or a rock garden. It can be a pretty simple feature, like just a basin lined with rocks. It's just the intention is to provide some topography to your garden to slow down that runoff and actually hold rainwater on your property. So yeah, a rain barrel or a basin are some ideas. A controller wouldn't qualify, but I certainly recommend them.
Just to really quickly, I know the city's gonna be doing it, but over at the Water District office headquarters, they have, their garden is laid out with QR codes. It's every plant around it. It is an incredible live environment to go look at and see what those plants are, and you can literally scan them and get the information. Right, Alexa?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, at our demonstration garden. It's called the Sustainability Garden at 4232 Las Virgenes Road, which is the Water District's headquarters. It's open to the public 24/7. We are currently reprinting signs, so please excuse if you come within the next few weeks. We might not have all the signs deployed, but there are signs there and more to come.
Thanks, Alexa.
Okay, a two-part question. On your plants, would you say we need to do our homework to see if they are safe with dogs, or are most of these plants, some of them poisonous, so we need to know about that? And also, as far as the mulch with the fire situation, which is the best mulch, or can you name a couple of mulches that aren't composted, for example, that you can put in that are fire resistant?
Right. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, definitely do your research when it comes to plants. For instance, I have a wild tomato plant, which is a California native, in my front yard. Turns out highly toxic to dogs. So we removed that. So absolutely do your research, because some of those same herbivory herbivory strategies to deter like deer, like Eric was mentioning, also may be toxic to your pets. So yeah, definitely do your research and know about toxicity. When it comes to mulch, organic mulch is always preferred because it feeds your soil and provides for soil health, but it is combustible. So that is something to be aware of. There's this whole concept, and if you come to our workshop on April 1st, of developing defensible zones around your home. So from the wall of your house to at least 5 feet out, we recommend rock mulch, so like a gravel mulch. It still, helps retain moisture in your soil. It still helps suppress weeds. It provides all those benefits. It just doesn't add the organic content to your soil that a bark mulch would. So gravel mulch is certainly a strategy. I will say when you apply for the rebate, it says in the terms and conditions that they require organic mulch. They will make exceptions. So if you let them know that you live in a fire-prone area, they absolutely make exceptions for gravel mulch.
Thank you.
This is for Eric. With the kits, how long does it take for it to take hold, first of all?
Great question. So, the ideal time to plant is in the fall. We are having one set of kits this spring, so it will be a little bit slower as far as that taking root because it won't have the irrigation, the natural from the rainwater. If you have a second, you can ask. I planted mine in November. Some of the species have about doubled in size, partly because we had that wonderful rain. So it partly depends on the time of year that you're going to plant. But you could be looking for a full season of growth. But it will really depend on the species, because I have others. I think, Heather, you'd, or maybe Alexa, you'd mentioned Matilaha. And so I got a lot of my plants from them. Some have doubled in size, and other species have not. So part of it is it's dependent on the species as well.
So since we have to wait to do the rebag, and that's all going to take time, so it doesn't pay at this point to get a kit. Will you be offering these kits all through? Because fall is coming, mm-hmm. and we won't be ready. If we plant this, then we don't qualify for the rebate.
Sure. So what I can say is due to our grant funding requirements, we're having a spring sale. I do recommend more so the fall. We will be offering more in the fall. But as far as the rebate goes, our kits are designed to replace 100 square feet. And if you remember, Alexa talked about, if you are applying for the rebate, it is a minimum of 250 square feet. So the kit could be, and I think this was even discussed in Heather's, and then the point about buying 10 plants, you can start small. That would not then be eligible towards the total rebate. My front yard was 680 square feet. I did it all at once. I removed my turf in September 22nd, 23rd. And planted early November. So I was able to get the rebate process did go through there. You can apply on the early side, and as Alexa mentioned, you do have 6 months to plant. But yeah, you can start now to get that reservation. It does take a couple weeks. The kits will be available in about 3 weeks from the start of the sale. So the 21st to the 24th is a Tuesday through Friday. If you started your application now, you could get that preliminary approval to get started. Absolutely, yeah, you can buy multiple. We're only making 150 available, partly as we are looking at logistical challenges that might arise. We are starting small. This program is based off of one in the Front Range in Denver, or north of Denver, and they sell something in the order of 4,000 at a time. They've been around for more than 20 years, though, so they have a bit of a head start on us. But that we are looking to grow the program to support homeowners.
Thank you.
Just to clarify, I'm right in the middle of the program, and they are allowing, because of the drought situation that we're in, they are allowing a year now to complete your process.
Not anymore as of March 1st. So applicants who submit an application because of the improved hydrologic conditions, that was an exception made for the drought. So for folks who did apply during kind of the height of the drought, they allowed for 1 year.
Right.
But moving forward as of March 1st, anyone who applies and in the future, we're reverting back to the previous policy, which is 6 months to complete a project.
And then in reference to the mulch beds, I've found out myself. I live in Deer Springs, and it depends upon what your fire rating is in that area. And believe it or not, in the north end of Deer Springs, it's only a 300-home community. In the north end of Deer Springs, they require mulch underneath the plants. In the south end of Deer Springs, you can do gravel with your plants because they're, and you can find out what zone you're in from the fire department, and it can vary. So I don't know how flexible they are, but I'm going to go by the guidelines that they, you know, have online.
Another question?
Let's make a quick comment about fire, because I think it is something that's really pertinent. I know I had to evacuate during Woolsey myself, where I live. The Fire Resilience Task Force that I actually met earlier this month, one of the pieces they talk about within that idea of making sure is that embers are actually your number one concern for fire. I don't really like the term home hardening. It feels very austere, but this idea of making sure that you're safe from the embers is absolutely vital. So if you have open gables or anything, make sure that you're, let's just say, preparing your home. That's going to be a bigger concern than mulch, but just as a kind of a PSA, I suppose. because if your home is at risk, then your neighbors could be as well. So making sure you're protecting your homes.
Alexa, my intention is not to be disrespectful, so please don't take it the wrong way. But I challenge your assertion of the utility of rain barrels, because sometimes it rains all winter, but then for the balance of the year, we really have nothing.
Right. Yeah, and that is completely fair. I mean, and to be honest, rain barrels, the typical household rain barrel is usually about 50 gallons, maybe 100. If we get 1 inch of rain on a 1,000 square foot roof, you're generating 600 gallons of water, so far exceeding the capacity of a barrel. Personally, my usage of a barrel at home during the dry season is I collect shower water as my shower warms, and I pour it into my barrel for storage for usage outdoors later. But yeah, unless we're doing large cisterns, which I know Melina is here, and if you have questions regarding, you know, deploying a cistern so that when we do have, you know, the freak rainstorms like we've seen in the last few weeks, and you want to capture, you know, we're talking in the volume of thousands, tens of thousands of gallons of water, you really need to implement a cistern to have that kind of year-round stability. A rain barrel is really just a tool, not so much for storage, but to slow water. So we always recommend, you know, having it open into a rain garden. So you fill the rain barrel and have it empty into rain garden. But no, realistically, you're not going to be maintaining your landscape in the dry season on a 50-gallon barrel.
Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely.
One more, if I may. Will copies of the presentations be available for us to take home? Or
might be a question for Beth.
Yes, we've recorded it, and so that's available online, so you can look that way, or we'll post it through the Environmental Commission page on the city's website.
Thank you.
Thank you.
My question is, how long do you think these rebates will be available right over here? I mean, improving water condition, are the rebates possibly only going to be available for a few months, or...
I mean, you know. I suppose that's possible. It's budgeted right now for at least 2 years. So it's guaranteed at a base rate of $2 per square foot through the end of 2024. So yes, for at least that period of time, I really don't assume we'll ever be in a strong enough position to forego it entirely. It's one of our kind of principal programs that has been going on for many years. We are consistently applying for grants to increase. So there were times where we could provide for customers $3 a square foot, even as high as $4 a square foot based on grant funding, but that base rate of $2 per square foot is pretty consistent, and I imagine it will be maintained well into the future.
Thank you. Question up here. Hi, Whitney.
This is for Heather. I'd love to see the city of Calabasas be a monarch sanctuary, and I'm wondering if there's a shortage of milkweed or if you have intentions of having more milkweed throughout the city so the butterflies can stop by.
Milkweed was actually one of the plants that we were supposed to plant down in Old Town. So yes, there is some shortage, but Through the Malibu Foundation, they actually had either, they either collected some seed or they're getting some seed from, and I'm not sure where, and that's one of the first locations where we're going to be putting some is at De Anza Park. I believe, to be honest, I'm kind of coming in on the back end. I wasn't really aware of it, so I'm getting little pieces. But the community services department is kind of taking the lead in working with them. I've only been in two meetings, but I believe it's March 18th, and there's supposed to be some flyers because there will be volunteers, and there'll be I came in and I located some areas, but that is one of the areas. It's going to actually be milkweed for like butterflies, different types of insects, beneficials, lace wings, and I was working, I honestly don't remember the young lady's name. She's actually working on the wildlife overpass. She's the biologist. She's amazing. Oh, she's so, so amazing. And so we I spoke with her and on site, and we found some areas and talked about some plants. So yes, that is gonna be.
Thank you. I also wanted to say, when you had mentioned there's different climates throughout the community, we live in the Highlands, and we did our native garden in February of last year, and in the summer, our garden was filled with color. It was so vibrant and so incredibly beautiful, so for some people, it might be quicker than several months. Ours was massively abundant in just like 4 months. And with the rains, our native garden has so many gorgeous colors again right now. So I'm excited for all of you to transition to that.
Thank you. Over here, question.
Did you have something to say?
Actually, I wanted to support your information about the monarch butterfly plantings. The Santa Monica Mountains Fund is a fabulous organization that works with National Park Services. And they have a native plants nursery over at Satwiwa, which is in Thousand Oaks, if you've been there. And Antonio Sanchez is this unbelievable guy who runs their nursery. He's a genius. And he is growing out plants to support the Malibu Foundation efforts. He will give you a free plant if you show up on a Saturday, you guys. You just have to volunteer for 3 seconds. And he is giving away, in particular, a lot of monarch-friendly plantings. And it has to be the exact right subspecies. It doesn't, you can't just plant milkweed. It has to be the milkweed. And so he's sourcing his plants from locally in the mountains. So great resource, and you can start your own monarch butterfly garden on Saturday.
Any other questions? Anybody? Yeah, Robert? Yeah. Yes.
Yes. So please help our student. I already bought three on your way out. Free water bottle if you buy the plant.
Yeah. And these are the students here from Roots and Shoots, Calabasas High School. And so all the funds that they are generating are going back to making sure that they continue to educate their high school community. Thank you so much for being here. Please, we'd love to make sure all their plants are sold today. Question. Yes, sorry.
Hi. Thank you so much for the presentation, all of you. It was so informative. My question is, we have a pretty large, steep hillside that is about at a 45-degree angle. And we're thinking about planting it with natives. And we would love to apply for the rebate program, but it doesn't really seem feasible to do the capture piece of it on the hillside itself, since the hill goes down to neighbors at the bottom. And so I'm wondering how we might get around that, or can we do a stormwater capture piece on a different part of the property that's not specifically associated with the hillside, or would that not count?
It would not count. It does have to be on the actual property where the project is being implemented. We did a slope garden at headquarters, and we did a series of not quite terraces, because that's a big engineering undertaking, but really just depressions and berms. So you kind of just build in a very like natural step into the slope. It is possible, and I'd be happy to, you know, take a look at your property and discuss maybe some options. I do have some business cards here with my contact info on them, because we are happy to work with customers on like a case-by-case basis and try to identify opportunities to meet the terms and conditions. And if there are instances where you really can't, then to advocate on their behalf through Metropolitan, and to make sure that for folks who are still wanting to transition from grass to native, that we find a way to do it. But yeah, there are some ways where you can build in kind of very subtle natural steps and berms, especially at like the bottom of the slope. If you could create kind of a berm to just when it hits the bottom, just slow it down so it doesn't spill onto the roadway. Or does anyone else have experience with?
My first question would be, is it sod or turf on that hillside right now? With that, that's what I'm wondering. I don't know.
Have to look at it.
Okay. What I will say is Tree People has a number of resources for contouring your yard, and it might help towards that as well to kind of create some of those rain garden depressions. And that is some of that material that will be available. Even if you don't purchase the rain kit, it is still available, and we are still making our resources from across our organization. There will be a digital version of the installation guide, so that if you're deciding you're not going to purchase it from us, we still have that available. But that's also probably going to be at March 1 at the earliest, probably a little bit later. I'm still finishing the design part of that. But we have some resources. Right now they're spread throughout our website, but we will have them collated into one section so that you could also peruse that.
One more question, I think, back here.
Should I stand?
Yeah, either way.
Okay. Hi. You had mentioned that Calabasas has a variety of microclimates, and we should plant our plants accordingly. How would I find out what microclimate my home is in?
Hi, Charlotte. Hi. If you want to email me or something, I'll look it up. I know where you live, so... I can help you. I'll help you. You're I know where she. I know where. I know the area. So, or I can. I'll write it down and I'll leave it up at the senior center for you to pick up or something. Okay. If. Well, or no. I have a book, and it shows me the different microclimates, and just some of the plantings that I have done. So you're welcome to. You can either call me or reach out to the landscape division for the Public Works Landscape Division, and I can make sure to let you know. I usually just need an address or a vicinity, and I can let you know.
Thank you. Well, we really appreciate everyone who's here tonight, because by coming tonight, you shared that you care about the environment and care to make a difference. So thank you. I know we're always trying to learn new things, and I'm so thankful to see how this night played out. I'm sure we can all think of something new we learned, one thing, and we couldn't have done it without the three of you. So we made these plaques as a small thank you to how much we respect and admire the work you do for the community and giving us your time and coming. So first, let's thank Eric Wilson. Thank you. Thank you. And Alexa Hendricks from the Las Virgenes Water District. Thank you. Thank you. And then last but not least, our very own Heather Melton. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.